provided.
Hallelujah.
It may look like you can't make it, but I promise you, you can.
Amen.
He will never put more on you than you can bear. So whatever it is that he has served you today with, he expects you to eat it in joy. While we're yet standing, be so kind to turn to Mark the 10th chapter, verse 46 through 52. Mark 10, verse 46 through 52. NIV, I do apologize. NIV today for a minute, I guess. Then they came to Jericho as Jesus and his disciples together with a large, were leaving the city. A blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet. He's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." Jesus said, "No, go," said Jesus. "Your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. And if I would use for a thought, "I want to see." Our Father and our God, we thank you. We thank you for this word. We thank you for what you have given unto me. I pray for every ear to hear, every heart to receive, every mind to obtain in the name of Jesus. I pray that every yield be yielded according to your purpose and your will in our lives. We bless you for all that you're doing and what you have done. We thank you for the man of God. We thank you, O God, for the strength that he is gathering now. We thank you, O God, for the healing that's taking place. We claim it in the name of Jesus. We realize that no weapon formed against him or any of your believers will ever prosper. And we thank you right now, God. Continue to be there with him and strengthen him and encourage him and guide the doctors in the name of Jesus. And we thank you today in the name of Jesus for the strength to continue. We ask your blessings upon your people, God, so noble and so great. Thank you for their faithfulness and their dedication. We pray, oh God, the blessings to be in their home. Bless them indeed. Enlarge their territory. Keep your hand down upon them in all manner of evil away, that it may not be grievous unto them. In Jesus' name we pray and praise you. We also ask you to remember our brother, Brother Baxter, in his hour of bereavement. Oh God, strengthen his heart and his mind and undertake for him in the name of Jesus. You know the need, you know the desire, oh God, and you know the inner request. We pray, God, for his inner strength in the name of Jesus as he take another stand. And we bless you for him. In Jesus' name we pray and praise. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. He says, "I want to see." What is the ability to see? It means to have vision or the faculty of sight, eyesight or sight. Visual Visual perception is the ability to interpret the surrounding environment using light in the visible spectrum reflected by the objects in the environment. This is different from visual acuity, which refers to how clearly a person sees. So when we look at the sight, the spectrum sight, it reflects off of the objects in the environment. You're able to see the coloring because of what is being reflected in the environment. You're able not only just to see color, but you're able to see people for who they really are because the light shines on their character. The difference is the visual acuity, it really allows you to see clear, you know, meaning in understanding. You have a clear understanding as to what you see. And most times people may misinterpret a person. They may think, oh, they look like they're mean, but all along they might be aching or having a pain, and the frown on their face is misinterpreted as a frown of bitterness, when it's a frown or a reaction of hurt.
Yes.
And sometimes we can misconceive what we see, so we say, oh, they're a mean person, but until you get to know them, wow, I thought you were mean, and no, I'm nothing like that. I'm just, you know, going through different things in life just like you are, but sometimes it shows on other people's faces. So what gives us the ability to see? The images we see are made up of light reflected from the objects we look at. This light enters the eye through the cornea, which acts like a window at the front of the eye. The amount of light entering the eye is controlled by the pupil, which is surrounded by the iris, the color part of the eye, meaning that there is an order in the eye in which you can determine the color, the shape, the size, and what you're looking at. So when you look at people, sometimes we look at people and we realize that some people can look at you, but they're not looking at you.
Amen.
You ever looked at a person, but you weren't looking at them? And then, what are you looking at me for? And you're like, oh, I'm sorry, I wasn't looking at you. But your focus is, what people fail to realize, we really don't see with our eyes. We see with our mind. And most people think, oh, I see you. No, what are you seeing in your mind? What are you perceiving in your mind? Amen. What you see? And when you look at the blind man, he had no sight. He had hearing, but he had no sight. And some people can have sight without having hearing because they can perceive what they're hearing as to what they see.
Amen.
And when I look at the blind man, he heard a lot of voices. And when they were walking by, he heard that it was Jesus. He didn't see him, but he heard him. He didn't just hear him, but he heard of him. What he was capable to do, his capabilities. And in hearing that he was walking by, he was refusing not to be seen. Isn't it something when you want to see somebody, but you simply refuse not to be seen?
Amen.
He refused not to be seen.
Yes.
Oh, you can see me. I can't see you, but I hear you're here.
Yeah.
And I need you to do something about my sight so I can see you. I don't want you to just look at me, but I want to be able to look at you.
Amen.
So the art of seeing can be broken up into four parts. First, we have to see our own seeing. He got tired of seeing what people saw, and he couldn't imagine what they saw. Oh, sit down. You can't do this. Oh, go over here. Sit down. Nobody want me by. But hang on, give me some change. And a rock falls in the cup. And he heard that. That's a different sound. That's a whole lot of money. Until he felt it and realized that wasn't it. So sometimes we only see what other people see. And sometimes people only want you to see what they see.
Amen.
And when you find a person that only wants you to see what they see, they want to control your vision.
Yes. Amen.
You will have limited vision if you continue to look through the eyes of others and put it in your view as the this is what it is. When God has given each one of us sight, not just sight, but vision. Vision is the most important because sight can trick you. But when God gives you a vision of something, it's for you to pursue it. So we see how the world recognizes our own and taken for granted assumptions and be able to set them aside. Because seeing, some people take seeing for granted. Oh, I see it. I see it. I don't got time. I don't see it. But some things God want us to pay attention to. And the things he's calling for us to pay attention to, we throw them over our shoulder and keep going. You got to realize you have an adversary at all times. And if you don't pinpoint him or view him as your adversary all the time, you're going to open one door and he's going to kick in the rest.
Yes.
The second, we have to see big. To see larger, to see the larger culture, cultural, social, economic, historical, and political forces that shape our everyday lives. We have to see things for what they really are. Barney is a dinosaur. He comes from our imagination.
Amen.
What am I saying? You can't just have an imaginary friend.
Right.
Jesus is not an imaginary friend.
Amen.
He's a real friend.
Amen.
He's one you can touch.
Yeah.
He's in touch with you. With the feeling of your infirmities. He understands what weaknesses are. He just didn't give in to them. That's the difference between he and us. We give into our weaknesses. We give into them. We pay that thing mind. We talk to it. We let it speak to us. And it says things it shouldn't say. And we absorb it. And we keep going with it. And before we know it, we're overtaken by that thing that has sight. We envisioned it. And now it has power over our real vision.
Yes. Yes.
The third thing, we have to see small. We have to pay close attention to the smallest details and understanding their significance. The thing is, we just want, I want this big house. What comes with a big house? Big mortgage. Big bills. Big food,
mm-hmm.
Big clothes, because you want to fill up closet.
Right. Amen.
So there's a bigger thing, but we want it, but we don't even appreciate where we are.
Amen.
Sometimes God will give you enough space just for you and him.
Yes.
For the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean that it has to continue to be in that area.
Yes.
The of smallness. But he just wants you to pay attention to what's around you.
Amen.
Because we want the big picture of everything. A large roof. That's a large roofing bill.
Uh-huh.
And we want the finer things of life. Please, you are supposed to. But where you are, sometimes we have to pay close attention as to where we are and what we have.
Amen.
Can you manage that? Is it feasible for you to go to the next level or to be or wait there and gain what you need to be able to obtain the next level?
Yes.
Because we can want a full house and it's just you.
Amen.
Four bedrooms, five baths, just you. You're not going to have company. Nobody's spending the night because you are particular. So God is saying, let's be real with that vision. What we see, the small things are fine. Manage that. Can you manage? That's why I remember with the talents, the 10, 5, and 1. The 5, 2, and 1. Why? Because he knew what they could manage. He said, I gave you one because I knew you wouldn't manage. And most of the time we compare ourselves to others as to what they have because we can see, oh, I see you got more. I see you got more than me. Well, what are you doing with what you have?
Amen.
Can you multiply with that one? See, if he would have gave me that, I would have been able to do this. But you told him I hit it.
Yes, yes.
And the thing is that what we see is what we're going to do.
Yes.
If you don't see victory, you're going to walk in defeat. If you don't see yourself coming out of a rut, you're going to stay in a rut.
Amen.
If you can't see your way on top of the mountain, you're going to go in the valley.
Amen.
So God is saying, I allow you to have challenges in your life to tell me what you see.
Amen.
He said, Jeremiah, in the dead set of winter, what do you see? He said, I see an almond rod. He said, thou seest well. Why? Because there was no budding on the almond tree.
Yes,
there was snow on top of it. How can you distinguish what it was? Because when you see with vision, you see more.
Yes, yes.
But when you see with sight, it's limited.
Yes.
That's why when you get saved, the first thing God gives you is a vision of your ending. Oh, I see me out there ministering, preaching this gospel to people and telling them about Jesus. But he never showed you by sight what you were going to encounter.
Yes, yes.
Joseph knew he was going to be great. Why? God put it on the inside of him, gave him that vision to know that he was going to be great. And he told him, one day you're going to bow down to me. That was vision talking. But sight took him on another route. The key to vision seeing is never lose sight of the vision because what you see on the sight road. Because the sight road is very discouraging.
Yes, yes.
You're like, oh, Lord, I don't think I can make it. Oh,
yes.
Go back and check and recheck. God, did you really mean what you said? Did I really see what I saw? Yes, you had a vision. And God wants you to walk in the vision, not by sight. We're walking by faith. That's what vision is. Vision is something that we've seen that we have not touched. But we can see ourselves in it.
Yes.
Joseph would tell him, he says, listen, I had a dream. I envisioned 11 stars bowing. That's the dream boy, the dreamer. But it didn't stop him. Even when they threw him in the ditch, he wasn't walking by what he saw, his sight, because he would have never imagined getting to the top by starting off at the bottom.
Amen.
The Bible says, do not despise small beginnings. Because people, you have a vision, you think you're supposed to jump to the vision. We really have to be prepared in order to get to that place. And the way we get prepared is being torn down. And that's not an easy place to be when you're big-minded. It does not mean change your vision. It simply means you got to keep the vision. But you got to be willing to go through the process.
Yes.
That's going to cause you to get there, but not get there, stay there.
Amen.
How many people get to their vision you've seen and they can't stay? Because you don't pack too many clothes.
Yes.
Or you didn't pack enough. And some things you're supposed to got rid of and you didn't.
Right.
We saw the effect of that when God told Abraham, go out. You and your family. And he took an extra being. Lot. A whole lot. Came with him. And got in a lot of trouble.
Yes.
And what God is saying, when I tell you to take something, I mean take it.
Mm-hmm.
When I say leave it, I mean leave it.
Amen.
I don't have to be in, I don't have to go in detail as a leave that and don't take that. Just take you and your family.
Amen.
You're like, oh, nephew, come on. But it was trouble. The trouble started because Lot had a lot like Abraham, but not as much as Abraham. And they was fighting. The herdsmen was fighting over feeding. They want to feed their herd, and he want to feed his, and it wasn't enough. He says, well, you take the land you see. And Lot took the plain land, because that's what he saw, plain. And that plain stuff got him in some plain trouble. Because sometimes God don't want you to just be plain, because being common means you're going to blend in with things that are common, but it may be against God. Yes. And finally, we have to see it all. Piecing all this together to see how everything we can see interacts from a holistic point of view. Is it really real? Struggles are real. Yes. Trials are real. Yes. Victories are real. Can you really see yourself in victory when you're in a defeated area of life, in life? Most people die when they go through storms because they can't see themselves coming out. And every day you have to realize that no weapon formed against you will prosper. And even though it looks like it's prospering and it looks like it's taking advantage of you, you still have to stand on that word that cannot return unto God void. That must accomplish that which was sent out to do. So you have to learn how to endure hardness as a good soldier as unto Jesus Christ. So you can't quit because you're going through. You can't talk negative because things are working against you. You got to join the side of Jesus and talk his language. You got to speak victory. You got to tell yourself, I'm more than a conqueror. I am an overcomer. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Hallelujah. And you have to know that greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. In other words, I'm not out in this battlefield by myself. I got more for me than the whole world against me. And that's when you might have to realize, like Elisha told him, he says, his servant told him, he says, they are more than we. He said, Lord, open his eyes. Sometimes you got to open your, ask God to open your eyes and let you see that you are more than your enemies. Amen. Because anytime you want to fight and you fight naturally, I promise you, you already lost. Yes. But if you get into a fight and it's spiritual, you already won. They were angry with Elisha because Elisha kept telling them what was going on in their room. And the king said, who's telling Elisha what's going on? He said, he tells us what's going on in your bedroom. When God gives you vision, you can see everything. Yes. You don't have to ask people what you're going through. Yes. Pray. Yes. God, what is it that you want me to know? He will give you the vision of the struggle and also give you the solution to the problem. Amen. He will not let you see a struggle and not be able to help. Amen. So what does it mean to be blind? Blindness is a lack of vision. Blindness is the inability to see anything, including light. Can't see anything, including light. What is it called when a person cannot see? Blind, lacking perception, lacking awareness or discernment, deprived somewhat of understanding, judgment, or perception, cause someone to be unable to see permanently or temporary. Blind. If the gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. He blinds the minds of them that do not believe. Anytime you stop believing, you become blind. To be blind means you do not have understanding. You do not have knowledge of. That's why he says, if you eat this word and you eat it in doubt, you are damned, meaning you can't see. You have no perception. You have no real knowledge of what's taking place. Okay, you're in a bad place, but he didn't count you out. But the problem is when you can't see, when you're blind, the mind is blind and it can't see, it cannot perceive what is taking place in your life. You can't see the hammer and the chisel that God is doing to you. You just see nothing. You ever bumped into somebody and say, oh, what do you see today? How do you see yourself? Oh, I said, I can't pay you. This is against me. I can't pay this. I ain't got no money. I ain't got enough money to pay attention. You see, that's what they see, and you can't change that.
Right.
The problem is we keep trying to make people see what they don't see.
Yes.
You can't make a person see the light if they're in total darkness.
Amen.
To see something really means to go after it.
Amen.
Blind Bartimaeus heard that Jesus was there, but he went after him. He was going, and he was hollering, hey, Jesus, have mercy on me, son of David. Have mercy. And I said, shut up. Sometimes people will tell you to shut up.
Yes, yes.
While you have vision. He saw himself seeing. He said, if I get to him, I can see.
Yes.
Or if he come to me, I can see. Let me holler out. Jesus of Nazareth, son of David, have mercy on who? On me. The problem is you're not asking mercy for you.
Amen.
You're so blind you can't see your way out of it. The light is shining at you. You can't see because you won't ask. The Bible says you have not because you ask not. Anytime you ask in doubt, he said it's a miss. In other words, it didn't mean anything. No value. What is myopic? It's the lack or loss of ability to see, not able to clearly see the things that are far away. And sometimes God wants you to envision yourself in the future.
Although everything I try, I fail. So I don't even have a dream. I don't have a desire. I can't see nothing. All I see is what's going on right here and now.
And most people have never made a plan for the future.
Why make a plan and you don't know what's going to turn out?
Plan to make it turn out.
Well, you know, I've been all my life trying and nothing ever worked for me.
Because you plan for failure.
Amen.
You really plan for failure because you said it. Every time I try, everything fails.
Yes.
So what were you really planning for? Failure. So you don't have a plan for success.
Come on.
Because in order to have a plan for success, it takes work.
Yes,
it takes planning.
Yes.
It takes vision.
Yes.
And most of the time, when you look by sight, you're going to fail. That's why the Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. Because sight can get cluttered.
Yes.
So what's partial blindness? It means you have limited vision. You can see something, but you can't see it clearly. You see it clear, but there's a fog behind it. So you have limited vision. So what is blind? Blindness is strictly defined as the state of being totally sightless. You can't see anything. And God doesn't want you to serve him without sight. You cannot serve God being blind. If Elijah would have began to serve God blindly, when he told him to go to the widow woman and she would sustain him, and she popped up with just, this is all I have in my hand. God crazy, she crazy, eat your meal and you die because I'm out. But vision pushed them there. Vision works with God. Sight works against God. Because when you see something through your sight, you get upset because it's not what you envisioned. It's not what you imagined would take place. So when you walk in with God and you walk in by sight, you're going to be distracted. God, this showed up. This showed up. That showed up. But when Elisha, the woman put the hand out with the meal in it, he said, do what you said. Make the meal, but give it to me. Had she not had vision after he said, feed me, he said, and you and your son will not go hungry. Had she not envisioned more food on the table or more meal and more oil, she wouldn't have participated in his vision. She would have continued in her sight because she pointed out what she saw. I only have a handful. And I was going to prepare this. Me and my son were going to eat this and die. Vision came along and said, serve me. This is the thing. When you don't serve God, you can't see vision. You only see what's right then and there in front of you. And God is saying, I'm envisioning, I'm empowering you with vision. Stick with me. You can't see your way. You got to believe your way. Had she not believed the man of God, it would have never materialized. She ate plenty, went to bed full, woke up ready to eat again to have the day full in a place where it was a drought. Can you see it? You see the drought, but you don't see the provision. You know what God told Elijah? Go to the widow woman. I prepared her to sustain you. When you walk by vision, it doesn't make sense. Yes. How in the world are you going to sustain me with a woman who presents all that she has? A handful of meal. And this is what God's saying. I don't want you to see your circumstances as it is. I want you to see it through the eyes of faith, of victory. Yes. Stop seeing your struggles.
Yes, yes.
I hear you. He said, your struggles are set there to build muscle. You're going to go through different things. But if you believe God, you got to go all the way. You can't believe, you can't play peekaboo with God. 1, 2, 3, red light. You got to believe him. Is it hard? No. Because when you die, you have nothing else to do but trust.
Yes, hallelujah.
So I want to see, what is spiritual blindness? Spiritual blindness is a grievous condition experienced by those who do not believe in God, in Jesus Christ, and his word. They are unable to see God or understand his message. Spiritually. God's not going to always blow. You're not going to always see the sun shining. It's cloudy days, but you got to know that the sun is behind those clouds. And one day you got to come out to see me. That's faith. You just took advantage of a dreary day and made it mean something. Oh, you can show up today. And you got to rain, because what you're raining on is going to produce.
Yes. Yes.
See, it's not until we envision the flowers, the trees, what's behind the storm. But as long as you are in the storm and see the storm, you can't walk it. Peter, in the boat with the disciples, storm arose. Jesus out on the water, in the storm. This is what people don't tell you. He gets in the storm. You're never going to be in a storm by yourself. I didn't feel all alone. No, Jesus is with you in the storm. What is he saying? It is I. Be of good cheer. Fear not. Don't be afraid. The 11 gasped for air. Peter saw an opportunity. Jesus, if it's you, bid me to come. Oh, the water calmed down so Peter could. No. It was a storm. And the closer you get to your vision, what you're called to, the worse the storm is going to become. But can you see yourself getting to where you need to go? Hallelujah. So Peter stepped out. I didn't say into the water and swam. He stepped out on something that we ordinarily was sinking. What was so different about Peter? He believed in come. He believed in the command, come on. Give me what you got. Peter said, I got faith in you, Jesus. And as long as you have faith in God, you can walk anywhere. You can walk on anything. But this is where your faith is going to be tested, the closer you get to God. Because if you don't continue in praying, and you don't continue reading and seeking and fasting and having a good time, a devotional set time with God, you're going to forget who he is. Peter, same wind, same storm, but it got a little louder. It was boisterous. It started doing stuff. The waves started slapping him. He said, Jesus. But the moment, hear me out, that you take vision and transfer it into sight, you have to see what's going on. And the things that's going on is going to take your mind, your heart, your emotions, your feelings, your knowledge, your wisdom, your understanding off of Jesus and on the storm. Now, Jesus doesn't make sense. Oh, I know I'm talking about
this.
The storm does. Because now we in reality. First thing we say, I'm being real. I'm being real. I'm in the storm. You was in the storm in the boat.
Amen.
Now that's real.
Amen.
You were in the storm in the boat. The real, the reality of it is that you walked on water. Why? Faith. Anytime you walk to God, in God, with God, you must walk by faith.
Amen.
If you do not walk by faith, you already are defeated. Oh, you're going down. But you better pray that you got enough strength to look up like Peter and say, Jesus, save me.
Amen.
Sight. So important. We never want to lose sight of what God told us. Because if you lose sight, you're going to start entertaining you.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to start dealing with reality. Because that's what people call reality. See, I got to deal with what's really going on. That's not going on. That's a delusion.
Amen.
That's to get you off centered off of God.
Mm-hmm.
That's to get you to stop trusting him. And you start trying to build a house. And you're building it on sand if you build it without Jesus.
Amen.
Faith will make you do some crazy thing. Yes. You'll dig until you get the rock.
Yes.
You better hit that rock. Acts 28, 26 and 27 in NLT. 28 chapter 26 and 27 verse NLT. Go and say to this people, when you hear what I say, he said, you will not understand. When you see what I do, you will not comprehend. For the hearts of these people are hardened, and their ears cannot hear, and they have closed their eyes so their eyes cannot see. And their ears cannot hear, and their hearts cannot understand, and they cannot turn to me and let me heal them. Hardened heart. Can't get bitter with life, because life comes to slap you.
Yeah.
Every day it's going to show unexpectedly. But you better trust Jesus. Put in your request and wait for God to answer it.
Amen.
If you don't see any answer, don't leave the request on the table. I left it on the table. Don't leave it on the table. Leave it with God. Let him know I trust you. I don't know what type of a season it is, but I'm in it with you.
Yes.
And I know you're in it with me. And I'm counting to have victory after this season.
Yes.
Oh, you're going to have seasons in your life.
Yes.
You're going to have a winter, you're going to have fall, you're going to have spring, and you're going to have summer.
Amen.
And then it's called due season. You do something.
Yes. Yes.
You're owed something, so it's going to be given to you. How about that? The D-U-E. So when you go through the story, he said, I can't deal with folk that don't believe. That's what he's talking about here in Acts. The 28th chapter, 26 and 27 verse. You don't believe, so you see him what I'm doing, but it's not making any sense. Stop trying to make sense of God, because he makes none.
Amen.
He just does what he do because he can. Well, I want to see how did you get the alphabet? You know, I want to know how did A come after B? Now, what is a B? It is what it is. We keep trying to dissect things when God just said it is what it is.
Yeah.
Everything is not spiritualized, y'all. Well, the Lord said, I just can't all the time what the Lord said. It bothers me that every time you speak, the Lord said it. He said, get up and get in. Okay, how about you know you're supposed to get up and get in there?
Amen.
How about tying that up? But every time the Lord always got something to say, and my Bible, he doesn't speak that much.
Amen.
And Lord, give me a word. Tell me what you said. Repent, for the kingdom of God is over here. Oh, he ain't talking to me. See, the problem is you keep trying to put everybody where God wants you.
Mm-hmm.
It's good to repent. It's good to say I'm sorry.
Amen.
It's good to apologize.
Amen.
It's good to tell God you love him.
Amen.
It's good to say the kind things to him. It's good to get up and bless him.
Amen.
I don't feel like it. I feel like he's shortchanged. Just bless him anyway, because he made you.
Amen.
And he knew you were going to be rebellious. He knew you was going to be rebuttal. He knew you were going to rebuttal. He knew you weren't going to give him everything. You just give him his hand and tell him to shake my hand. He said, I don't want your hand, I want your heart.
Yes.
Problem is we keep making God so local or so common. He's not like your natural dad or your natural mom. He's different. He's better.
Yeah.
Will you be tested and tried? Because he can. He can test his product. He got to test the product before they put it out on the market. Isn't that what the iPhone people do?
Yeah.
You ain't never got an iPhone and they ain't tested. If it didn't work right, could you not or can you send it back?
Yes.
You can send it back. You can't fix it.
No.
Can't try to fix it. Can't tamper with it. You got to tell them, look, it ain't working like you said. Mm-hmm. No manufacturer wants their product not to produce as to what it said it could do. What? That's what Jesus said. I'm making you. Yeah. I don't like the way I'm being made. He said, one time has the clay said to the potter, yeah. What are you making of me?
Wow.
Let me see what you're doing with me. That clay didn't say that.
Amen.
And God is saying, you are the clay and I'm the potter. I'm making you what I want. Well, I don't like it. So now it's called rebellious.
Yeah.
Now you are a rebel. You have come up against the plans of God for your life because you don't understand it. Why you gotta do me like this? What did I do? You were made to be remade. He said, Jeremiah, go down to the potter's house. Because Jeremiah was complaining.
You want this, all I'm going to get. Come on, God, you ain't got nothing better for me. Go.
He said, Jeremiah?
Yeah.
Go to the potter's house.
Okay.
Observe. The potter was making something. Didn't like what he was making. Tore it down. And did it again. And God said, can I not do to you what the potter has done to the clay? God just want to do stuff to you. He don't want you to look like everybody else.
Yes.
He putting you on the shelf and you got to be the first thing people spot. Wow, it's different. So unique.
But you want to be the same. Which one's not like the other? Can you tell me before I'm done?
Because I don't want you like everybody else. I've created you to be different. But you want to look the same. And usually, if you have a good eye, you go for something that's different.
Yes.
Well, I don't want that. I want that.
Yes.
Something that no one else will ever pick. That's why God picked you to go through. What? Yeah. Because he's making something of you that you can't identify with. That's why nobody can come and encourage you like you need to be encouraged until you go in prayer.
So true.
Amen.
So true.
Amen.
That's why when you're supposed to get things, you can't get it. Because nobody's going to make a way for you to have it. Because God said, I want to be your sole source and supply.
Nobody want to help me. I help everybody. I mean, I get everything.
God says, now it's my turn to bless you.
Hallelujah.
My turn to show you
yes.
what you really mean to me. And he said, I'm thanking you for being a blessing to those that couldn't bless themselves. He said, that's what I'm doing. I'm thanking you. So I'm about to bless you in a way that nobody else can get blessed. So our problem is we keep trying to look like everybody else when God says, I don't want you to look like anyone else. I want to see you for who I made you to be. When I see you, I want to see me in you. No, I'm really looking to see me in you. That's why you're going through them hammering and chiseling stuff out of your life and things that you thought was yours. And he's saying, that ain't for you. Because what I want to do, I'm going after that heart that I made to be pure, that made to be in touch with me, that cries out to me and I answer and they know I'm there. And even though it looks like I'm away from them, they say, I can't go to me because I just believe in God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And he's saying, yes, that's what I want. I want to get in that heart and I want to rip it apart and I want to rebuild. Because I'm after somebody with a heart after me. Hallelujah. That's why David got special treatment. Because David could see himself in his arms. He said, even if you don't let me in the kingdom, I could be a doorkeeper. He envisioned him being close to God. If I don't get in, I'm going to hold that door open. And this is what you have to come to realize, is that when God allows you to go through things, it's just for you to get closer to him. Can you see yourself in his arms? You're that lost sheep that he went after. And when they find the sheep, the shepherd picks the sheep up and don't put them on the left shoulder, the right shoulder. He puts them on the left with the heart so he can feel the heartbeat. And that's what God does. Although God is working all around us, pursuing us and showing us his glory, some people cannot perceive his divine workings. Bartimaeus cried out to Jesus, "Have mercy on me, son of David." Mercy. That should be our cry. Have mercy. It's not enough to feel your way or be led by the way. You want to see your way.
Yes.
Turn the lights out. I mean, pitch dark and dark in the windows, and it's really dark. No matter how much you've seen in the light, there's a difference when darkness shows up.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 4, 3 and 4 says, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds. He blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." Why is the world looking like that? Because they don't believe. Why are they acting crazy? Why you don't matter and they don't know you? Because they don't believe God. They don't believe in God. And when they don't believe God or in God, everything else is dark. You included with your light. That's why you have to pray before you go out. Let your angels encamp around me.
Yes.
Lead and guide me. Protect me from danger seen as well as unseen.
Yes.
Let my eyes not witness death.
Yes.
You got to pray.
Yes.
People are lost for real.
Yes.
Oh, tis, tis, tis. What a shame. Look at the world. It's crazy. Where's your light?
Yes.
You can't turn your light on and put it in the bag. Oh, they know who I am. No. Not you acting like them.
Yes.
Got your war clothes on. I'm not going to lose on that. No. Okay,
right?
People are looking for love.
Yes.
We're not supposed to have it. We do have it. I got to tap into the love. No, love lives inside of you.
Yes.
He actually lives inside of you. You got to die.
Yes.
I find this, and I've said this before, I find this to be so very true. People are trying to be Jesus when Jesus comes in them. He wants you to be you and let him live in you. He didn't change anything about Peter for real. Peter was who he was. And when Jesus got in trouble, Peter showed Jesus who he was. Who was he? Sword swinging Peter? Cut that ear off? What? Jesus said, no. No, he said, that's why I gotta go away. Because if I don't go away, the comforter can't come. He said, it's going to be me living in you. And if I don't go away, Peter, you will always encounter Peter. You will always swing a sword. He said, but when I go away, I'm going to send the comforter. And he's going to comfort you in every uncomfortable situation. Huh? Why? Because Peter, I don't need you to cut nobody. He said, those that live by the sword will die by the sword. That's why when you try, because Christ living on the inside of you. When you try to engage or entangle in the warfare of this world in a natural sense, that's why you feel bad, because yes. you just denied Jesus a chance to shine.
Yes.
And it's called guilt. Because you know better. You know how you know not to do something. But I'm going to do it anyway, because ain't nobody going to jump me. You ain't died.
Yes, so true.
Jesus said, unless the seed die, he can't live. What do you mean? You got to die in Christ. You got to let your ego deflate.
Yes.
Pride got to die. That's the thing that separated Adam from God. It wasn't me. You see, that woman you gave me. Pride.
Yes.
No, it was a command I gave you that you didn't do. He never owned up to his wrongness. It's not until we own up to our wrongness that we are able to see us for who we are. It's not until you admit you're wrong. As long as you are lying and prideful, I ain't do it, I ain't steal that cookie, I wouldn't steal a cookie and the crumbs around your mouth, I ain't steal that cookie. Well, who put the crumb around? I don't know what you're talking about. Well, why is the cookie on your teeth? I don't know. Look, you did it, you did it. The world's not coming to an end because you did something. Own up to it, learn accountability. The church is missing accountability. Well, you know, Jesus loves all of you, and Jesus has rules.
Amen.
Well, God had rules. He wrote them out, said, this is what's going to be in my kingdom.
Amen.
He didn't say y'all couldn't do this in the world. He said, in the world, you're going to have confusion.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm not the author of confusion. I'm not going to tell you to do something that I mean don't do it. I'm going to tell you what to do and not what not to do, and you got to abide by my command. He said, if you really love me, you're going to keep my commandment.
Amen.
Make an excuse to be in darkness, to walk in blindness. You can't walk blind.
Amen.
When God opens your eyes, it's a difference when you can see.
Yes, yes.
If a person doesn't see God, doesn't know God, unfortunately, they are spiritually perishing. They are dying because they don't know him. They can't see him. They can't perceive him. Many rebuked him. Remember blind Bartimaeus? Many of them rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Why? Because it wasn't their deliverance. It wasn't their need. That's why you don't need people to validate you as to what you need or who you are.
Amen.
Do you think I need that? If I feel like you in my way, I'm going to tell you no.
Yeah. Right. So true.
So true.
I know you're going to be honest. I am. I'm just not telling you all the honesty.
Amen.
Amen.
No, you don't need that. You sure? I believe what you say. Yeah, I'm telling you. You don't need it. You get a couple of more dollars and go back down there and buy what... Ooh, you had, why you get that? You knew I wanted, you told me. Girl, I was waiting for myself.
Yep. Amen.
Amen.
Stop letting people validate you, approve you. Let God do it.
Yes.
Our problem is we skip the one who's supposed to, we supposed to go to.
Yes.
Let me go to this. Let me see what you gonna say. Now see. I was praying.
See, that right then and there, I'm lost. Because if you was praying and he ain't answering, I don't have an answer.
But what do you think? I don't have a,
listen, I got so much going on in my life right now, I don't have time to think for somebody else. But I'm going to tell you one thing. If you wait on God, he going to answer. I promise you. You just got to wait. The problem is we don't like to wait.
Well, I'm going to go over here and see what you think.
I don't have a thought. I keep my thoughts to myself, because if you really heard my thoughts,
you wouldn't like me.
Amen.
Being honest. Sometimes I'm like, what?
Oh,
I'm sorry. Let me get out of here because I got to move. Because you, I can't believe you asked me that. And you really want me to answer you? Now I'm going to go. I ain't going to go get it. I'm not even going to give it to you. I'm going to say, I don't know. I can't help you. I'm so sorry. I know you're a praying woman. I got to be praying if I'm staying here listening to us. You can't believe some of the stuff people just literally ask you because they think that you are the only one with a relationship with God. No, I'm not. He said, take my yoke upon you, learn of me. His yoke is easy, his burdens are light. You want to go past the work. See the cake already made. Don't know if it's a real cake now. Got the icing on it.
Amen.
You don't know what it tastes like.
I want that cake right there. It sure look good.
You better take the cake. Can you still have a sample?
Amen.
Listen, if you don't work out your soul salvation with fear and trembling, you're going to be messed up. Because these people today that are leading, I'm scared.
Yes.
Tell my prayer. Please don't put your hands on me.
Amen.
I'm scared.
Amen.
Because I don't know what you live like behind closed door.
Right.
And I don't want that demon chasing me or sitting next to me. No.
Amen.
Because I love prayer. Learn the power of prayer.
Yes. Yes.
Learn that you can pray for yourself.
Yes.
Or if you find somebody you do believe that can get a prayer through, link up with them, but don't hold on to them too long.
Amen.
Get the prayer move. Folk got some stories to tell you after they pray. You're like, look, I ain't answer that. Just pray. You know how to pray? Yeah, just pray and leave me alone. That's my attitude.
Because
folk got some stuff with them. They, look, all these big old folk up in the big old arenas and all that stuff and got all this junk in their trunk. And they want to cast out demons. No, I ain't got one. I ain't got no demon.
Amen.
I don't associate with none of them.
Amen.
This is the thing. When God shows you where you're going, he also has to hammer and chisel you to be able to fit there.
Right.
You're just not that perfect puzzle to get there.
Amen.
So what did he do with Joseph? Joseph had pride. You go bow down. Okay. Now you got to bow.
Yep.
Now you have to be humiliated.
Yeah.
You got to be lied on.
Yes.
Got to be mistreated.
Yeah.
Going to prison for something you didn't do, but you can't prove it.
Wow.
Why?
Wow.
God was after that unsettlement in him, that big pride that was up there. Are you gonna bow? That's why they hated him. Who are you? And daddy gave you a coat of many colors? Ew, let's cut this coat up. Yeah, why? Because Joseph got used to being king. He was rolling. His father sent him to spy on his brother. I know you ain't gonna lie to me, JoJo. Go on out there and follow those little heathens. It's bad when you make a difference in your children.
Amen.
But it's bad when you don't acknowledge they have a purpose.
Amen.
Gotta learn how to balance it.
Amen.
So Joe goes behind them. Here come the dreamer. Let's kill him. No, don't kill him. Don't kill him, Reuben. Don't kill him, boy. Don't kill him, baby boy. No. He goes away, come back. He's going, what y'all do to him? They killed the goat and he died. He died. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. What are we going to do?
He said, no, he ain't died for real. We just sold him.
You're going to get sold into stuff.
Yeah.
Because of your vision.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're going to go to prison because of your vision. And I don't mean always in the prison, but you're going to be locked up. You're going to be limited for in the prison.
Yes.
Until God's ready to bring you out. And he going to deal with you in a vision.
Yeah. Yeah.
With somebody else.
Yeah.
They going to have a dream and you going to interpret it. And you still going to be stuck.
Bless you.
Huh? But I have error. everybody, and you're going to be in charge still.
Yeah.
Because I'm grooming you in leadership. When God grooms you in leadership, I ain't say put you in leadership, but groom you in leadership, you won't be a leader, but in prison. You're going to be able to lead, but you're going to have limitations. Why? God is teaching you how not to disrespect him when I loose you. Can you see it? This is wanting to see. You have to see the whole picture, the big picture. Why is this happening to me? Why that happened? Why I got to go through this? This just happened. I can't believe this happened. God said, I'm putting you forward.
Hallelujah.
But I got to make you look like you are behind.
Hallelujah.
Blind Bartimaeus made it specified that he wanted to see, but others thought he was a waste of time. People going to think you a waste of time.
Yeah.
They don't have time for you. You so beneath them that they don't even want. They count you like the gum on the bottom of your shoe. How then does it come to pass that the gospel is hid and proves ineffectual as to some who hear it? How? Because they don't believe. Because you say you are in the light and you live a messy life. You say you have the light, but you live like darkness. So what do they see? Confusion. How can you believe if you're confused? If you don't know what's great, which way to go, you ever took a route and it says turn, but the signs look like they're going the same way, and you took the sign you thought was saying that way, and your router, your GPS says reroute. Now you gotta find how to reroute and get back on the road where you need to go. Well, this is what God is saying. When folks see you, they should not go reroute. The apostle answered by showing that this was not the fault of the gospel nor of the preachers. Those are lost souls whom the gospel is hid or is ineffectual. Why? Because the most Bible that people will ever read will be your life. Paul describes Satan as the cause of spiritual blindness. The God of this world has blinded their minds. They are under the influence and power of the devil, who is the prince of this world. Yeah, man, let's get together and kill. It's nothing for them to come in agreement with that.
Mm-hmm.
Get the church together. Yes, come together and pray. What? I don't want you praying with me. Who you think you is? You calling for prayer. The church is falling apart and the world is coming together.
Amen. Bless you.
The church lost its power.
Yes.
But it also doesn't mean because you are in charge of something that you gotta bully people.
Right.
Intimidate them, manipulate them, or dominate them, make them feel like they're supposed to be inferior to you. No! I refuse that spirit. As high as you may think I am, I'm low. I'm common. Why? Because I don't want you to ever think that when you get behind this place that you got to make people feel like they beneath you. That's not God. Even Jesus walked among sinners. I'm not saying he did, come on, baby, come on. No, no, no. He didn't do all that. He knew who he was. Who he came to be. The perfect sacrifice for us. And you are going to become a perfect sacrifice for somebody else. The homage that is paid to him by multitudes in this world, the great sway that by divine permission he bears in the world and in the hearts of his subjects, or rather slaves, and as he is the prince of darkness, Satan, and ruler of darkness of this world, he darkens the understanding of men. They fight up against love. And they embrace hatred.
Amen.
That's what Satan is about, hatred. He comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. And he's not going to stop until he completes all three. The increases, this increases their prejudices and supports his interest by keeping them in the dark, blinding their minds with ignorance and error and prejudices, no spiritual riches and no holiness of heart, so that they do not see their state. They don't see, it's bad when you don't see where you are. It's bad when you don't see your wrongness. What is it saying? That no light is shining unto you that you can understand that you are wrong. It's preventing them from beholding the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God. First of all, if we don't get this thing together in Christ, we're going to confuse a lot of people. He's not about hatred.
Amen.
He's about love. The only way you can get in, he says, with clean hands and a pure heart. And your soul can't be lifted up to vanity. So you got to change when you come in this kingdom. There was a wedding. Clothes were provided. A man comes in and won't change. Sits at the table. Person here in charge said, who told you to come in like this? He said, I came as I was. He said, you came as you were, but you didn't change from who you were.
Amen.
And the Bible says he was kicked out into the outer darkness. In other words, he was kicked out into hell because he couldn't see himself changing. Oh, tell somebody, God, I want to see.
See,
I don't want you to see nobody else. Sometimes you got to see yourself.
Amen.
You have to be honest with you.
Yeah.
You always point at you. You ain't seen. You'll never be seen. You going to hell. In fact, hell is calling you right now. Boop. Wrong. Because we haven't examined ourselves. Paul said, examine ye yourselves. Take the time to find out where you're wrong. And when you start seeing you, you're going to be crying. Sorry. Oh, God, mercy. Have mercy on me, son of David. You're going to view you as not all of that. You really don't have it together. You're pretending. And the worst thing to do is pretend, because you pretend too long, it's going to become a reality.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 2:14 says, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Everybody can't discern this word. Everybody can't read it, because they are spiritually blind. To be spiritually blind can also be translated as being spiritually undiscerning. As explained, in the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. There was no way Peter should have got out that water and walked on water.
Amen.
Out of that boat, excuse me, and walked on water. No way. Try it right now. Because naturally, you going under. Because there's no solidity unless it's ice. And it wasn't ice. It was cold, but it wasn't ice. So, for they are folly to him when you cannot understand the things that are spiritual. It doesn't mean it's, God doesn't make sense. I told y'all that. But if you are spiritually inclined, he makes all the sense. But the moment you step out of the spiritual realm, That's dumb. That ain't no. That's real dumb. Two fish and five loaves of bread and all these people. I don't see that. Two fish, five loaves of bread. He had too much bread to start with.
only going to use what you have. He told him, he said, he didn't even ask them, do they believe? He said, go get what he got. Give me something. See, you got to give God something to work with. Give me something. 2 fish, 5 loaves of bread. The Bible says he blessed it and broke it and passed it. Everybody was full and 12 baskets was left over.
Yes. Amen.
Oh, that's only 7. I was going to say, oh, because it add up to 5. No. See, I tell you, people want to make everything so spiritual. 5 plus 2 is what? 7. 7 plus 5 is 12. Don't add up. Oh. It's just God. When we can begin to give God his credit, his props, what's due him, and honoring him, you're going to see a lot more miracles today. All right, I'm going home. Okay, so, wait. Okay, this means that to be spiritually blind, to be a spiritually blind individual, spiritual things are meaningless. So if you're spiritually blind, Christ is meaningless. This gospel is meaningless. And the light shineth in darkness, and darkness comprehended it not. Oh, the light was shine. God showed you. But you couldn't understand it. A lot of times we can't understand God is because we are in sorrow. What's the matter? Can you shut that noise up? Why are you crying?
I'm mad.
What you mad about? Oh, wait a minute. Let me go find out what I'm at. What? But see, what I'm saying is that it makes no sense. Just like that didn't make any sense, neither does the gospel make sense to those that don't believe, because you have to have faith. Jars. Walking. Going. Came to Jesus. Can you call my baby sick? Okay. Somebody in between them interrupts. Jesus, take the time to deal with this. 12 years. Dealing with infirmities. I'm going to take a handle of this. By he dealing with this, if you're not careful, it looks like Jesus is taking too long of a time. You can't see and understand why he's doing this to you. And the reason why you can't see and understand is because it's all about you. When you realize that God is big enough for your problem and other people's problem, take your time, God, because I know you're coming to handle mine. Get there. They said, don't trouble the master. Your daughter is dead. Jesus turned around and really said, the same faith you started out with, let it take you to your daughter. And I promise you she'll get up. Death is not the final note for us. It means we're going to the other side of light. Don't sit around as those that don't have hope. We have hope in God. Knowing, okay, you might be absent from this body, but you're in the presence of the Lord. What can you do with that? Nothing but thank him and try to get there. Make it your business to get there. So he gets there and he says, only believe. Now if somebody come and tell you your daughter dead, that's conflicting. But he clung to what Jesus said. The problem is, as soon as you hear a disaster, you forget what Jesus told you to do at the beginning. Trust me. Why did he say trust me? Why did he tell them not to fear when they saw him? Because he knew the storm was going to get big. You act like
like Jesus don't know what you are about to encounter or what you have encountered.
Bless you.
Say what? You know what Jesus said? I got you. I'm gonna tell you what you're gonna do. If he told us everything that was gonna happen to us, how are we gonna walk by faith? Wait a minute, let me go back and tell you. Lord, tell me what. Okay, what? Oh, I know what's going to happen. So right then and there, you and Jesus become so bosom that you don't need to trust him.
Yeah.
You figured it out.
I don't know.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. What? Yeah, watch. And it does happen. Told you. Told you. Now you're going to start looking at that person and believing them instead of believing God.
Amen.
Why? Because they look like they got the answer.
Yes.
That's why I say seek God.
Yes.
I promise you he's going to talk to you. Yes. He does not have a respecter of person. I just love to be in his presence.
Yes.
And when I'm not there, I'm crazy. I got to be there because I started something with him a long time ago. Seeking him. And you don't seek, oh, I got this. No. I am afraid of people who know Jesus.
Amen.
And I don't mean know him. I mean pinpoint know him.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Jesus is going to do that. Me and Jesus, high five him on. High five, Jesus. That's the disrespect they have for him.
Yeah.
When I say I know Jesus, I'm on my knees.
Yeah.
I'm praying because some days I know he's there. And he doesn't always feel like he's there.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I have to know in my mind and in my heart, you can't leave me. I tag him with that every day. Oh, you can't leave me. And you can't forsake me.
Yes.
You got to be there.
Yes.
And even if you don't show your presence, I'm not walking alone.
Yes.
It's like most of them said. He said, if you don't go with us, we ain't going. If you don't cross that river, those fences with us, we ain't going.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because we're going to die without you.
Yeah, 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 man.
Look, I can't leave Jesus. As bad as things have happened and are happening right now to me, I don't have nowhere to go.
Amen.
I ain't find comfort in nobody but Jesus.
Amen.
And that's what he wants. Why? Because I saw myself in his arms. I saw me there. And when you can see yourself in his arms, you got to get there.
Yeah.
It's not enough to see the vision. You got to go to the vision.
Yes.
What does that require? Work.
Amen.
Huh? Oh, Lord, I just saw me in your arms, and I thank you. And I said, no, get there.
Amen.
It's not enough just to see it. You got to get there. He wanted to see. I heard you did it. That's good. Ears are working very well. Feet are too, because I walk to you. But that's not enough. It's not until it's not come enough that going after him, you got to see more than what you see. He said, those who reject God's word are spiritually blind. Joel 5:14 says, they meet with darkness in the daytime and grope in the noonday as in the night. In the daytime in darkness. That's a bad thing. You ever slept so long and then you woke up, it was dark?
Yes.
You're like, oh wait, what time is it? 5 o'clock in the morning? Oh my goodness.
Yep.
And it's 5 o'clock at night?
Yep.
Well, imagine living like that in the daytime, trying to feel your way out because it's so dark. This is what it's like when you don't believe God. You get to walk in darkness. You got to feel your way. That's why it's hard to go through what you're going through because you stop believing God to help you through where you are. They meet with the darkness in the daytime and they have an affectionate desire, look at that, to be in darkness. They search for it in the noonday as if they are searching for something that is beneficial for them with the lights out.
Wow.
Find that ring. Oh my God. Ain't no ring in darkness. They cannot understand the truth of scripture, which sounds foolish to them.
When an individual rejects Christ's message, he is unsaved and needs his eyes to be opened to the importance of Christ in his life. Satan, who is the father of lies, he aims to lead humans away from God's truth in any way he can. Anyway, about to encounter some hardship or hard time, and Satan's right there to catch you. He want to make a rebound. He want to score with you. The Bible calls him extraordinarily evil, the cause of all temptations and the destroyer of the flesh. He even attempts to blind believers.
Yeah.
You ever got sidetracked?
Amen.
And you a believer? You ever saw something for what it wasn't?
Amen.
And thought it was?
Yes.
Who do you think sent that distraction?
Amen.
Don't get lonely.
Yeah.
He ain't sending Prince Charming.
Amen.
He's sending that frog that ain't changing.
Amen.
And then when she kissed that frog, he changed it to the prince. Well, that toad ain't changing.
Amen.
Why? Because he was sent from your enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Satan gives you what you want. Jesus won't. He gives you what you need.
Amen.
And we don't want what we need. I want what I want when I want it.
Mm-hmm.
So now you got the toad.
Yeah.
Huh? Ribbit. You, excuse me, we got to go down here and pay some bills. Ribbit. Grabbing flies and mosquitoes. And you coming home with something because them mosquito carries everything now.
Absolutely.
Get my man, huh? How come everybody else can see that toad but you?
Amen.
My handsome prince.
Amen.
With it. Y'all gonna stop playing. I said he even attempts to blind believers, seeking to trap us and cause us to be distant, to distance ourselves from God through temptation, fear, loneliness, worry, depression, and persecution. It is easy to succumb to the devil's schemes when we are separated from God and relying on ourselves. Don't figure out your situation.
Amen.
It's not even good to question God while you're in it.
Amen.
Sit back and just bless him.
Yes.
Just thank him. I'm telling you from experience. Because when I started, I don't make no sense. 1 + 1 = 2. Okay, 1 + 1 = 2. And God's doing multiplication.
Mm-hmm.
1 × 1 = 1. 1 on 1 with me.
Yes.
We don't want that. We want 1 + 1 = 2. And that's confusion if you're doing multiplication. 1 × God = 1.
Amen.
1 faith. 1 baptism. Now here come the extra. Many feelings. We don't want that. The world is enticing. Along with humanity's strong inclination to make ourselves happy clouds over God's wants for us. We want to be happy. I just want to be happy. You want what? I just want to be happy. You want to be happy? Yes, I just want to be happy. Well, what does God want? I just want to be happy. Fasting and praying. God got everything you need.
Amen.
Everything you desire.
Amen.
But are you willing to wait for it?
Amen.
Well, see, I done found this one, man. This is the right one for me.
Yeah.
But Dr. Jekyll ain't come out. Because he had.
Uh-huh.
And when he comes out, he gonna reveal he ain't a real doctor.
Amen.
He needs the doctor.
Okay.
Okay, so when people persist in disobeying God and serving themselves, he gives them over to spiritual blindness. Romans, the first chapter, talks about that. I'm not going there, but you read it. He said they took natural affection and turned it to the unnatural. Women started lusting after women, men after men. And God said, these are people that knew me because that's what they wanted. Happy. They weren't happy. When you go after happy, you're going to get away from God. It's unnatural for a woman to want a woman. It's unnatural for a man to desire a man. But because the law of the land justifies this, we say it's acceptable in the house of God. It is not acceptable in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
The church is going crazy. Well, see, Jesus is love. Okay. And I agree. He is so full of love. Who would come and die for a wretch like me? I ain't talking about nobody else but me. Who would dare want to take my place? Me. Just me. I know you want to say me too, no, but me. Who want to die for me? Anybody? No, thank you, stop lying.
Because
when you get to that place and they go to trial, never I change my mind. I ain't going to be mad. That's why I said, who would dare die for me? Who want to take my place? I was to die. I was committed to hell. I was supposed to be there. But Jesus took my place, gave me righteousness, and he took all of my unrighteousness. That's why I cling to none. Why? Because that doesn't belong to me anymore. I don't want it. It's defiling. It's defying what God has done for me. It's like I'm taking Christ and crucifying him again on the cross all over again. As if once wasn't enough. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. That was 1 John 1:5. What causes us to walk in darkness? Hebrews 12:4. Because we have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. You got to fight against sin.
Yeah.
Sin going to show every day in everybody's life. I ain't saying just your life. Everybody's life, sin going to show up. It's very tempting. It's very appealing.
Yes.
It's flesh satisfying. It ain't soul satisfying.
Amen.
It's flesh satisfying.
Yes.
Ooh, wee. Yeah. But at the end of that is death.
Yeah.
And that simply means also separation from God. That's a bad place to be. I've been separated from God. I don't know about nobody else. I messed up. I was separated from God. I was trying to figure out how to get back there.
Amen.
And it's so sad that when people know you backslid, that they don't tell you all you got to do is repent.
Amen.
They watch you fall in a hole. They go, oh, poor baby. I knew she wasn't going to last.
Yeah, so true.
But I got misinformation in the church. I stood up and testified. I was young. I was 16. I was saved. I stood up and testified. Just thank God for being saved. I didn't know anything, y'all. I didn't know nothing. I had no knowledge of, no experience of nothing. And I said, amen, thank God for being saved, and sat down. They said, amen. Not wrong. Listen, that's your testimony. I'm not knocking it. Jumped up and said, how was so-so? I did this and I did that, but God saved me. And the whole church blew up. Yeah! mind. I need to go back out there and get a testimony. I went out there and almost got killed. And I came back and the Lord said, your testimony is going to be that I can keep you. I'm grateful. I didn't leave because God wasn't doing me good. I gotta get a testimony like this so people can say amen. Hallelujah. I went out there. I can't even tell my testimony. I can tell you this. He tried to kill me. He would try to kill me. He had it out for me. I mean, it was like one ditch after another ditch and a bigger ditch and a whole big, deeper ditch. And I was just down. I gotta get out of here. One day I heard the Holy Ghost say, call. I said, Jesus, I said, forgive. I said, I can't stay here. I cannot live out here. I don't want a testimony. He said, your testimony is going to be that I can keep you. And I ain't looked back since. Amen. Have I been in trouble? Yeah. Things been rough? Yeah. But then, no way. Because you got to know where your enemy is. And people say, get close to your enemy. You better, no, don't you keep that joker close. Don't you keep him close. You rebuke him. The Bible says resist the devil. He'll flee from you. But you got to submit yourself first to God. Resist the devil and he'll go from you. Don't you keep that joker close. He going to do some unadulterated things to you. He be like, no, I can get him out your room. Okay. God wants standard bearers, believers who are willing to make a blanket covering over their anointing. I just can't do everything. I can't watch everything. I can't sit everywhere. Amen. I just can't. Why? I got to cover my anointing. Amen. That is so important when you cover your anointing. Certain things people say, I'll be like, oh, they said that. It's not like I'm a weirdo. It's just like, ooh. Baby, you all right in there? Uh-huh. It's like when grown folk get the cussing around babies, yeah. And the babies sitting there scared because they've been seeing the fighting. Now was the argument. Now they fighting. And, that's why my Holy Ghost. Yeah, I mean, come on, we gotta go. Ain't my baby there? Where over there? The believer is a wrestler, a fighter, striving, fighting against sin. What the writer is saying is that up until now, no blood has been drawn, meaning the fierce severity of the conflict had yet to come. In other words, the enemy's going to try you in your flesh, but your spirit got to be elevated over your flesh. Remember when they were at when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he told them to pray? Yeah. Why did he say pray? That you don't enter into temptation. That's why you pray. So that the flesh won't be weak. So that you won't give vent to the flesh. Because the flesh is going to say some crazy things. It's going to stir up. It's going to be like, ooh. And if you're not careful, you're going to go, ah. You're going to go along with it. Yes. It's out to destroy you. Your flesh is your number one enemy against you along with Satan. Amen. They all on the one list. The world, the flesh, and the devil. All number one after getting you. That you have no right to give in and no excuse for being exhausted. I'm tired. I'm just tired. Breathe, inhale, exhale, and go in it again. Well, Lord, I can't do all this. No, you don't have an excuse. Because if you check out the history book, people went through worse than you. Yes. Can you imagine being Job for one day? Everything gone. I said one day, not a week in between, amen. A couple of days or hours, amen. Or all at one moment, all the car, this go, that go, that go, this go, that go, what? All he can do is shave his head and pray. We shave our head and go talk to everybody. You know what? You look what God did to me. That was gone. I know he mad at me. God ain't mad at you. Amen. God wants your undivided attention. Yeah. Graciously, God offers a way of sight. Left to our own devices, humans are spiritually blind and without hope. But Jesus is the light of the world, and he can open our eyes to see. Jesus stopped and said, call him. So they called the blind man. They said, remember before they was like, sit down, shut up. Nobody can hear you. Get over there. Be quiet. Nobody can talk to you. We see you, but you'll never see us. And they might have popped him in the back of his head. Sit down, don't you bother. I'm like, don't want noise. Jesus, son of David, see me. Mercy. I'm gonna have mercy on you right now. So they called to the blind man and they said, cheer up. Get on your feet. Why? He's calling you. Guess what he did? The Bible said he threw his cloak aside. He had to wear a cloak stating that he was blind. Excuse me.
Sorry.
He had to wear a cloak, and the cloak symbolized that he was blind. Mm-hmm. When Jesus called him, it said he threw it off. He no longer wanted to be identified as being blind.
Yes. Come on.
So when are you going to throw off your blind cloak? It's time to change your clothes. It's time to stop walking in sickness. You can't have a thermometer taped to your head. Cough syrup on your shoulder. Come on, with a straw. Amen. What am I saying? Stop nourishing in your sickness.
Yes, yes.
Go for the healing.
Yes, yes.
Go to see better. Go for the vision. God showed you something.
Yes.
Show it to me again.
Yes, yes.
I want to see.
Yes.
I want to see me in victory.
Yes.
I want to see who's been persecuted.
Yes.
I want to identify the enemy for who he is. Because if you're not careful, you can't understand who the enemy is when storms come. The first thing you view the storm, God knew the storm was coming. It was God's doing. But no, he allowed the storm to affect you. But it will not cause you to stop producing. Throw the cloak aside. He jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. What did he do? He threw off his outer garment, which signified that he was blind. He threw it off, full of joy at the prospect of being healed.
Hallelujah.
Yes. He ain't calling you for nothing.
Yes.
He ain't troubling your water for nothing.
Yes.
You're not going through just to be going through because you're going through. You're going through for a purpose. You about to see better now than you did before.
Hallelujah.
He about to reveal to you who you are.
Hallelujah.
You about to look in the mirror for the very first time and be able to say, I am a child of God. He threw it off that he might run without impediment. Nothing hindered him. Nothing was hindering him. Nothing. They couldn't grab the cloak and say, get back here, because you know you blind and you got to stay that way. This is what God ordained for you to be, and you got to stay stuck. That's your name, Blind Bartimaeus. B.B. Because you know how we are. We're going to give you an initial. B.B. Hey, B.B. You know who? You, Blind Bartimaeus. So this may be used as to illustrate the way a sinner should come to Jesus. He should throw away the garments of his limitation.
Yes.
First thing you say, watch it, simple devotion. Can you lead to, I can't do that. What? I can't do that. Why? I can't do that. What do you mean you can't do that? I just can't do that. Well, what? Is it that you can't do? I can't do that. I just can't do it. What? You put yourself in the box and you know why you're there.
Amen.
So with me, hello, I'm going to kick you out the box.
Yeah,
you better, huh?
Yeah, get there.
Why? Because I'm not doing it. Because I can do it. What? I can do devotion, but I don't want to.
Oh.
It's time for some of you to get up and pray.
Yes.
And I don't mean to talk about that. I may be down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, oh Lord, take my soul. What? That ain't how I go. I'm talking about praying the word of God.
Yes.
The word is in you.
Amen.
Ain't nobody no sad. I love that. You ain't sick, you crazy. You crazy to speak limitation in a place where God is healing.
Amen.
You struggling? Get out of here. God wants you to face your adversities. You're going to get in trouble, but he wants you to face them. Trouble going to show up, but you got to show trouble. I ain't scared of you.
Amen.
You have done the last thing you could do to me, and that's what I said. You have no idea where I'm fighting right now, but I'm not giving the enemy any credit. You done the last thing you're going to do to me today.
Hallelujah.
And I'm going today after I leave here in vengeance.
Hallelujah.
Why? Because I already have the victory.
Yes.
I'm letting the devil know. I'm setting the record straight. You're not going to win this.
Amen.
You're not going to. Listen, I mean, the stuff they think they doing and getting away. Oh, she's showing up.
Amen.
Big Bridge is showing
yes.
up. And I'm telling you, because if you don't go after the enemy and attack him after where he's attacking you, you're going to succumb to everything he do to you.
Yeah.
I'm not subject to him. I live a victorious life. If I got to fight, I'm going to fight in faith, knowing that I have the victory.
Yeah.
It's time to get up and start fighting.
Yeah.
Every time the devil do that, hey, we don't go to sleep. He done knocked me out of Mama, I used to be like, I don't want to fight, but they out there. She said, you got all that mouth. You gonna talk about what you gonna do. My mother kicked me out that door. Honey, she said, you ain't coming in until you do something. That's how I learned to fight.
Amen.
Because I can find safety in there.
Amen.
They said, you gotta stay out there. You started it, finish it. Well, I had to shut my mouth or fight. And guess what? They weren't letting up. They weren't saying, no. My sister came out, made sure they ain't jumping. One on one. That was it. I bet you one thing, I learned how to turn their nose on down.
Amen.
Why? Because every time I got out there and said something, my mom said, you start, you got to finish it. So I learned not to start so many.
Amen.
But I learned not to fight.
Amen.
But see, what God is saying, I already put the fight in you.
Yeah.
You fighting up against God. And God said, your enemy's right there.
Yes.
And you like feeding them both, keeping your enemy close.
Yeah.
What?
No.
That ain't even scriptural for
Amen.
The believer.
Amen.
Resist him.
Yeah.
He should throw away the garments of his limitation. He should rise speedily. You should run with joy. You should have full faith in the power of Jesus and cast yourself entirely upon his mercy. In Christ, we are given spiritual sight.
Mm-hmm.
And we can exercise this spiritual sight by allowing God to reign in our lives and by following his commands, which shields us from Satan's trap. If you don't want to be trapped, follow Jesus.
Amen.
Sometimes the things he tells you to do, you're like, praying fast. Now I'm hungry.
Amen.
Praying fast. A whole week. What time you want me to come up? 12 o'clock. Thank you, Lord. You aiming towards 12 and more than what he wants.
Amen.
Although Satan aims to blind even believers to God's goodness and his promise, God has provided us with the spiritual armor that we need to be safe from the devil's schemes. Jesus is our light, and we need to cling to his truth so that we are never blinded to God. Jesus is the light that can save us from living a life estranged from him. In my closing, it says, Mark 10:52, and Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto the Lord, that I might receive my sight. Jesus asked Bartimaeus, what he wanted. Jesus knew what he needed. But he wanted Bartimaeus, listen, to ask for it himself. Can you pray for me? What? Pray that the Lord bless me? No. No. God wants you to ask him to bless you. He do. Is it selfish? No. Was it selfish for blind Bartimaeus to get his sight? He said, I want my sight. It's not until you realize that Jesus has what you want and you have the right to ask for it. You won't get it. That's why you're struggling with, if he could help me, can you pray for? No. I don't do auditioning prayers. That's an audition. When you can pray yourself. He said, come boldly to the throne of grace. I'm not saying we can't pray together. Please don't misinterpret that. But I'm saying, when you say you want me to pray for you, that you get blessed and happy, thing, I ain't praying that prayer no more. I used to. The people would get it. And I'm sitting there like, I pray, but I don't need to pray for yourself now.
Amen.
The same belief you have for them to get it, believe that you can get it. And guess what? Yes. You will get it.
Yes.
You might not get it as fast as you issued it out for somebody else, but you're going to get it. You got to wait. So Jesus cured the man's eyes, and he cured him spiritually as well. Why? Bartimaeus continued to show faith in Jesus because he became a disciple.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. We thank you for sight. We thank you for wanting to see. We thank you for allowing us to see. Yes. Continue to open our eyes, our ears, our mind, that we may be able to obtain your goodness. We thank you for salvation that you have given unto us, that we may live according to your purpose and your will. We ask you, oh God, to continue to pour out as you have promised that you would. Continue to bless this man of God. Let your angels encamp around him in the name of Jesus. Guide the doctors. God, read the blood reading better today than it was yesterday. We thank you today for the healing in the name of Jesus. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. We bless you for blessing us. We thank you for this moment, for this season of going through, because we know on the other side of this suffering, we have victory. Hallelujah. God, we thank you for the victory. We thank you for just bringing us out in advance, God. We bless you. Hallelujah. Because we count it all done in the name of Jesus. Now, bless your people so noble and so great. Grant them safe travel and mercy wherever their final destination may be, God. Let your angels encamp around them in the name of Jesus. Give them victory today, God. Open their eyes that they may see in the name of Jesus who they are and whose they are. In Jesus' name, we pray and praise you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Bless you.